Howdy, historians. Welcome to your last video lecture. Welcome to the last lecture of AP US History for content. Here we go. Last day of notes, you guys. Woo! Yay! Let's order pizza. Oh, Mr. Montgomery brought us donuts. Wah, wah. Never mind. We can't do any of those things. But that's okay. It's still exciting because we're finishing things up. We'll have a couple more videos about, you know, feedback on the DBQ and getting ready for the AP exam and all that good stuff. But here's your last day of notes. So we're going to finish up World War II. We've looked at so many things, the causes, the mobilization, the fighting, the home front. Now we look at diplomacy and wartime conferences. So there were four big conferences, Casablanca, Tehran, Yalta, boop, and Potsdam down here. Now, to make it easy, these conferences, we'll just talk a little bit about them, then I'll show you a sheet where you can study it and get some info, okay? Now, these conferences are going to be kind of attended by what we call the Big Three. They're leaders from the United States, Great Britain, and Russia. They met secretly throughout the war to coordinate military strategy and then lay the foundation for peace thereafter. So, you have Stalin from Russia, aka the Soviet Union. In England, you have Churchill, and then later Attlee, after Churchill resigns. And then in the United States, you have FDR for a lot of it, and then Truman at the end of it. So those are the big three. Now, if you go over to the topics page, in the download section, you can find this, World War II Conferences and Diplomacy. Here's my key. All right, typically you guys fill this out on your own as a little homework assignment, but instead, here you go. You've got the keys to the castle, right? Casablanca, Churchill, and FDR. They're talking basically about D-Day and how they're going to ask for surrender. You should study this and read it more. Okay, I'm just giving you a little overview. Tehran, you've got Churchill, FDR, and Stalin. We're talking about, again, D-Day and then what's going to happen thereafter. Then you've got Yalta, Churchill, FDR, and Stalin, where we're talking about what's going to really happen afterwards, dividing Germany, free elections, starting to, ooh, boop, there we go, divide up some areas, creating the United Nations down there at the bottom. That's something I probably wanted to highlight. And then the last one's Potsdam. This is where Truman comes in, and this is where Attlee comes in for Great Britain, because FDR is dead, and Churchill is out. War crimes for Nazis. So check that out. Study that some more, but there's just a few highlights for you. All right. Yes, I do want to save. Thank you. So lots of meetings going on. Now, one of the things I do want to take a couple minutes here to talk about are the elections of 1940 and 44 and then the passing of FDR. All right. So these conferences are important because, you know, we still have to have meetings during the war and figure out how things are going to play out. These elections are also really interesting. You know, in 1940, the big question in this election on the eve of war was whether or not FDR is going to run for a third term, right? Because the first time he is elected is in 1932. That's when he beats Hoover. Then he's reelected in 1936. Now, on the eve of the election in 1940, remember, there's no constitutional amendment yet. You can run for as many terms as you want. It's just been a precedent. It's been an informal precedent passed down since Washington that no one runs for a third term. But we're still in the Great Depression. War is on the horizon, right? So these are very challenging times. So what FDR said, he said, I will run for a third term only if I win the nomination. If the Democratic Party nominates me, I will go for it because then I'm listening to the people. If they don't, I will gladly step down. The Democratic Party nominates him, overwhelmingly so. He was challenged by a guy by the name of Wendell Willkie. He was a lawyer and executive from Indiana. But FDR won because we had started to see very strong economic recovery by that time, and the fear of war was right there. Right, voters want experience when you're getting ready for a time of war. You don't want a new guy getting thrown in, learning how to be a president, and also, hey, here's the biggest war that the world has ever seen. Because you got to remember, as we're ramping up for the election of 1940, all of Europe, except for Great Britain, Switzerland, Spain, Sweden, and Portugal, have been taken over by Hitler. So every country except for Great Britain has been taken over, except for those countries that Hitler made some deal with or countries that have neutrality. So people didn't really want to see a lot of change, and FDR just absolutely dominated 1940. Now in 1944, less interest in this election than usual because of the war, and most people in the United States felt, you know what, because we're in this very large-scale war, and you got to understand, World War II is a war that we've never seen. It's way bigger than the Civil War, way bigger than the American Revolution, Spanish-American War, War of 1812, anything like that. Most Americans thought, we shouldn't have a change in leadership. Most people trusted FDR and felt that he had good, steady leadership. So FDR sought for and received the Democratic nomination this time. He didn't say, hey, whatever the Democrats do. He said, no, I think I should be the guy. But they did give him a new running mate. Before this, he had had Henry Wallace. Now they get Truman. He's from Missouri. He's more moderate than Henry Wallace had been. During this election, FDR was starting to wither a little bit. He denied that he had any medical problems, but those close to him recognized the uncertainty of his health. The Republicans ran kind of like a young, energetic governor, but FDR dominated. Now, he's only going to last 3 months after his fourth inauguration, and then Truman's going to serve out the rest of the term. But FDR dominates the elections in 1940 and 1944. Very unusual elections, right? 1940, FDR says, if you give it to me, I'll take it. In these uncertain times, the Democrats give it to him, he dominates. 1944, he says, I think I should stick around. And the American people say, you're right. And he's the only president to ever serve more than 2 terms, because after this, we'll pass a constitutional amendment saying you only get 2. Now, the death of FDR. The last conference that FDR went to was Yalta. And he announced to the world that he had made these agreements with Churchill and Stalin. He announced them to Congress and the world. At this time, it was becoming pretty clear that his health was deteriorating. And on April 12th of 1945, he was resting at a vacation home in Georgia, and he died unexpectedly. So he was taking a little nap on April 12th, 1945, and he passed away. The shocked nation, and people really were shocked because most people didn't understand how bad his health was, now look to this totally unknown Truman, right? Truman was pretty unknown. He's a senator from Missouri. How are you going to handle the enormous responsibilities of commander in chief during a war that was yet to be won? So this is huge, right? But Truman actually handled himself very well. Truman overall is considered a successful president. Part of it is a little bit of coincidence. He came in at the right time. The Allies and the United States were winning World War II by this point. It was kind of a matter of time. He did a good job figuring out how to handle the dropping of the atomic bomb. He wasn't too aggressive. He wasn't too skittish with it either. And then in post-war America, he had some good legislation as well. But FDR dies April 12, 1945. Truman is in. And he was the one that oversaw the end of the war. He was the one in office for Victory in Europe Day on May 8th of 1945. And of course, he's in office for Victory in Japan Day, VJ Day, August 14th, 1945. And he's the one to guide the United States to peace and prosperity thereafter. So as we wind down the war, just a couple things to think about here with the war's legacy. This is the most destructive war in the history of the world. It has serious effects on basically every nation in the United States. I mean, just think about this. Here's some crazy numbers. 15 million people died in battle. 45 million civilians died, including the Holocaust. 45 million civilians died. The death toll's probably north of 60 million people, because those numbers vary too. People don't even have, we really don't have good numbers on civilian deaths, because there were so many areas where there were large-scale civilian deaths that we weren't measuring very well, like when Japan took over China, when Japan took over portions of Southeast Asia, like the Philippines. Those numbers aren't reported very well. There's even, do we really know how many people passed with the drop of the nuclear bombs? We have some idea, but I'm sure we're missing some. All historians agree on that. Carnage in North Africa and Europe, we really don't know. We don't even know how close we got, but at least 60 million, 60, 000, 000, 60 million people died. 25 million wounded. I mean, that's crazy when you just think about the loss of life. I mean, it's so many people that passed in this, right? And this is just a chart of all of the loss of life here. So you can see all the military deaths, civilian deaths, total deaths. Total deaths as part of the population, right? That's kind of a crazy one. When you look at total deaths as part of the population, right? Look at the Soviet Union, you guys. They lost almost 24 million people, right? Military, civilian, I mean, it's crazy. China, about 20 million people, right? Look at Poland as total deaths by percent of the population, right? Because of the impact that the Holocaust had on them. Right? They lost basically more people than they had because so many people identified as ethnic Poles or Polish Jews. I mean, it's crazy, these numbers, right? These numbers are startling. They're alarming when it really boils right down to it. So the loss of life is nuts. It's just nuts. And it's when so many people, if you lived through this, you were impacted by it in so many ways. In the United States, we were lucky because we were victorious. Everyone came home a hero, right? That made it easier for people like my grandfathers who went to war and saw the war and lived through it. They never talked about it. Never talked about it. They'd give me little details here and there. Didn't want to talk about it, but and they had PTSD. We just didn't know what PTSD was. But at least you came home a hero to a parade. That made life a lot easier for them. When it came to costs, again, lives are a big part of it. Obviously, dollars are a big part of it too. In the United States, over 300,000 Americans lost their lives in battle. Over 800,000 were wounded, and we spent about $320 billion, 10 times the cost of World War I. By the end of the war, the national debt had increased fivefold from what it was before. We have paid off most of World War II, hooray, and most of the Great Depression spending, but wars are expensive. So there was a huge cost in life, there's a huge cost in dollars, and then we have to rebuild everything that was destroyed as well, right? So, and that's kind of the loss of innocence for young men who went off and fight, and just all the changes that happened from rationing and changes back on the home front around the world, right? Around the world, huge changes. Another big part of the war's legacy is the creation of the United Nations. People realized the League of Nations was ineffective. The League of Nations did not prevent World War II, so everyone understood we needed a stronger international peace league after World War II. And remember, the United States never joined the League of Nations, even though it was Woodrow Wilson's idea. We joined very quickly the United Nations after World War II, and in April of 1945, 50 nations got together in San Francisco to create the United Nations, and then it was October 24th of 1945 that the United Nations opened in New York, and obviously still operates today to try to keep the world safe and to try to prevent violence and war from happening. United Nations is a small part of why we haven't seen any true large-scale war since World War II. Another part of it is the threat of nuclear weapons. No one wants to go to war because everyone's terrified that if you do so, you're going to start a nuclear war and you're going to go into a nuclear holocaust and nuclear winter. But the United Nations, it gets a lot of flack, but it's actually a relatively successful organization in terms of world history. The last legacy of World War II, we can just categorize as expectations. There are a number of new expectations for the world and for the United States after the greatest war in the history of mankind. First, there's this general idea that the United States would be better and more prosperous after the war than it was before. And this is something we know to be true. First, the United States was untouched by the war, right? We had the attack at Pearl Harbor, but that was it. Europe had the brunt of the war. Right, the countries of Southeast Asia and the Pacific saw the brunt of the war. We didn't have the loss of civilian life and the destruction of a society like others did. We came out untouched, and we came out with the most powerful weapon that mankind had ever created, and we had a monopoly on that weapon. People understood we were going to be better off than before. We get to rebuild the world now too. Why do we go into such a great economic boom from 1945 up until 1968 or so? Because we're rebuilding the world because everyone else needs us, right? People also looked forward with optimism to the world being more peaceful and more democratic because we did start to increase the number of democracies around the world with some nation building that took place after World War II, but also because the world took a step back and went, holy cow, what just happened? And people that lived through the war would do anything to prevent other large-scale wars because they saw how terrible things were. But there was also a darker expectation on the horizon that some people saw, and that was the expectation that there was going to be a showdown between Russia and the United States, that these were going to be the two major countries because they were the two major victors that were the most untouched by the war that came out the best. Even though Russia had a huge loss of life and saw a lot of casualties and negativity in the war, it's communism versus democracy. It's Stalin versus the presidents of the United States. It's nuclear arms versus nuclear arms. And the rest of the world would have to live with this quasi-war, this Cold War, well until the 1980s, until 1989, when we can really say that it ends with the crumbling of the Berlin Wall and the reopening of peaceful talks between Russia and the United States. So World War II changes everything. Absolute game changer. Take a class on it in college. Go get some more info on it. There's all kinds of good stuff. But that brings us to an end for our look at World War II. Hop over, quick little quiz. Keep your notes out. Do a good job on it. Last day of notes for APUS. We'll start to focus our attention to DBQ writing and getting prepped for that test. You guys can go into that test and absolutely dominate it. Great job this year. God, it kills me to not be able to say that to you in person. Great job this year. I'm proud of you guys. Until next time. Great job.